I'm excited to start a new series tonight called Good Vibes Only. The subtext of the series is a dose of reality for a confused culture. And there is this idea in the world today that people just want good vibes. Does everyone know what good vibes mean? It's like good feelings, everything positive, everything high, upbeat, nothing negative, no drama, all that stuff. And the sermon tonight to start off the series is called YOLO, You Only Live Once. And the reason it is called YOLO is because there is, of course, many cultural statements, and we're going to address those during our series. And so we're going to go all the way for several weeks. There'll be different ones. And the culture today is obsessed with good vibes, good feelings, everything going the way they want it. And I think it's really well-intentioned, but it really goes off the rails as far as the Bible goes and truth goes, because people start throwing out these one-liners as if they're for sure and they're true. And some of the things you might hear, it's all going to work out, right? People say it's all going to work out. And truth is, it's not always going to work out. I don't know if you've figured that out yet in your life, but if not, you will one day. Some others, you only live once, so live it up. So tonight we'll deal with YOLO. Other ones, just follow your heart. Who here has heard, just follow your heart? Yes, everyone, if you grew up on Disney. You're going to change the world. It's like the classic statement when you're down in the dumps. You don't feel like your life is, like you're never going to be famous, you're not going to be a YouTuber, and someone says, hey, it's okay. It's all going to work out. You only live once. Just follow your heart. You're going to change the world, right? We attach a lot of these. You know I'm not kidding. You're going to be so famous one day is another one. God just wants you to be so happy. That's another cultural ism, if you will. I don't point out what's wrong. I just love people, right? I just want to love people, which love is very good. Just let go and let God, right? That's a really good one. Let go and let God. Your truth is your truth. My truth is my truth. That's another one, right? You do you, and I'm going to do me. And then another one, God hears everybody's prayers, right? Everybody who prays, there's not a single person. If you just pray to God, he's going to hear you. Well, why a series like this is so vital is that there is a kernel of truth in every one of those statements I've just made. There is some small aspect, or it could even veer to an aspect of truth, but most of them, if not all of them, are not just a little bit untrue, they are laced with lies. And some of this will shock you. So we're going to go through the series, and each week we are going to tackle a cultural statement that you are going to hear now, you've already heard, and you're going to hear for the rest of your life from the world around you, and you need to know what to believe and how to address it. So turn in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews is way back towards the end of your Bible. If you have a phone, pull it out, grab the YouVersion app, or go onto Safari or whatever you go on to and type in Hebrews chapter 9. We're going to be in verses 27 and 28. Two short verses, really easy to digest and understand, but these are big concepts, and this is going to crush YOLO, or better yet, it's going to shape the idea of YOLO. So Hebrews 9, verses 27 to 28. And I'm going to ask you guys to stand. We're going to have some reverence and respect for God's word. So I know some of you visit from other places or you're not used to this, but that's okay. We're going to have reverence for God's word. So Hebrews 9, 27 to 28, the author of Hebrews writes, "And just as it is appointed for a man to die once, and after that comes judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him." Let's pray real quick. Stay standing. Father, thank you for these young people who are here tonight, who love you and who are learning more about you, their God, and what it means to live a life of bold and courageous faith. Teach us from your word. Help us to understand the way that the culture operates, but even more so to understand what your word has to say about it, because we know the most important thing is not to understand this world, it's to understand your word. And so help us to do that in the midst of a world that seems to be more and more against you. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys can take a seat. So when it comes to these statements, I want to reel the tape back a little bit and say this. I think it's really well-intentioned. I think people really just want to be helpful. They want to, make you feel better. And so they either purposely ignore or accidentally overlook the truth of God's word. Not to be nitpicky, because nobody walks around wanting to crush everybody's dreams, right? That would not be the goal of your day or your week. But it is so important for you guys to understand that your feelings don't have the final say about your future. The culture today, the world we live in, does not get the final say about your future. Not at all, not in the least. God's word, if you're a believer and you guys claim to be a follower of Christ, God's word gets the final say. And so statement number one tonight, you only live once. It's the idea that you only live once, so live it up, try everything, get the most pleasure out of life. You know, things might not be good for you, but if they feel good, it's okay. Just do what you want. Don't listen to your parents. Don't listen to your pastors. Don't listen to government or authority. Authority bad. Your feelings and desires good would be some of the dichotomies that get created. And at least for a little while, this idea really works out. You only live once, so live it up. And you start to do that, and things are exciting. And you're living on adrenaline, and everything's kind of a rush until you end up, like so many people, broken, stuck in whether it be poverty or a dead end in your life, broken relationships, diseases, imprisonment, even death. Because the idea that you only live once, so you should just live it up and do what you want, never ends well, ever. Nobody is going to get around that idea. If you continue to go your way and do it the way you want to do it, it may not be now, it might not be in 2 years, 5 years, or even 10 years, but eventually, you'll look in the mirror one day and you'll wonder who in the world you are, how you became that way. Thankfully, God's word takes YOLO and it pushes back on it pretty hard, but in a way that would be constructive. And so let's look at it with eyes of a student, a learner of the Bible. Hebrews 9:27, and just as it is appointed for a man to die once, and after that comes judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time. I want to break down that first verse, verse 27. Just as it is appointed for a man to die once, and after that comes judgment. The larger context here is a whole chapter, and really a lot of Hebrews, is about the sacrifice of Jesus for your sins. That he atoned for sin. That he went to the cross and he died. And it was good enough that you don't have to do anything else. You don't have to work your way to heaven. Jesus is enough to be the way to heaven for you. And the author of Hebrews makes it really clear. Everybody's going to die. It's appointed to a man once to die. Nobody is going to get away with immortality. It doesn't matter what the movies say or what Twilight tells you. You're not going to be a vampire. You're not going to be immortal. You are going to die. I'm going to die. Everybody is going to die at least once. And then after that comes judgment. That is the judgment that doesn't necessarily take place immediately after dying, but in the future. Now, there's two kinds of judgment that we're going to experience. If you're a believer, you are, if you've ever heard the idea of rewards. Anybody heard the idea of rewards in heaven or the blessings of God? Okay, that's the concept that one day you're going to die, and then at a future point in time, you're going to stand before Christ, and he's going to say, all right, and he might use different terms, but to paraphrase for you, what did you do in my name? What did you do with the gifts and the talents and the life that I gave you to live? And then you're going to tell him. And he is going to reward you based on that. That is a clear concept in Scripture. For other people, if they rejected Christ, judgment is not a very fun thing. There's not going to be this moment where Jesus says, hey, so you were just kind of bad. You get 1,000 years in hell, but then after that, we're going to let you into heaven. Or hey, if you crawl across broken glass on your knees for 100 years, you'll have paid the price for all that you did because you weren't that bad, right? You stole a few lemons off the neighbor's lemon tree. You cheated on a couple of tests in college, but overall, pretty good person. So you just get 100 years, you know, you're going to crawl across, whatever. It doesn't work that way. You get one shot, one life, one chance to follow Christ, which is why people spend their lives preaching to you, ministering to you, discipling you, evangel. Why? Because people know, preachers know, families, parents, Christians know that have gone on before you, that this will be the one opportunity in your life to surrender it all to Christ, because it will be appointed to you. It already is. Your days are numbered. God knows how long you will live, and everybody is going eventually to die. And so, to say it another way, for you as believers, you're not saved by your good works. Your good works will never get you to heaven, but you are saved for good works. God saved you, and he loves you, so you would have purpose, or so that, or as a result of, you live with purpose. You live on purpose. You use your gifts and your talents for God. Those aren't going to get you to heaven, but because God has saved you and given you a way to heaven, what do you do when you're on earth? You live all out for him. And so that's really what the author of Hebrews wants everyone to understand. But he continues, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, in other words, everybody has to die once. Well, guess what? So did Jesus. He came as a man, lived a perfect life, was still fully and truly God, gave himself as a ransom for many, took the wrath of God on the cross so you didn't have to. The full wrath. The cross, the nails, the crowns, the abandonment, if you will, of his Father. And then he rose from the dead to prove that he had power over death, so that if you would believe and trust in him, well, guess what? If you believe in the Son of God who gave himself up for you and has power over death, well, how in the world do you think you're going to have eternal life? Because of him. See, you can't have eternal life if you believe in a God that doesn't conquer death. But because Jesus conquered death, guess what? If you believe in him, death is not the end. So yeah, YOLO, sure, on earth, you only live once on earth, but you and I, all of us, are going to live twice. Two lives. Once on earth, physically here, and then it has been appointed to you and I once to die. And because Christ died, that is certainly evidence. And that he rose again, rather, is certainly evidence that he's given us a way to eternal life. But when does that happen? After you die. After you die comes judgment. He bore the sins of many, went to the grave and rose from the dead so you could too. And so the question becomes this, where will you spend your eternity? Because you'll only live once on earth. Then after that, it's eternity. And people think, oh, eternity is always heaven, right? We're going to live in eternity forever. We're going to live in eternity. Yeah. Well, hold on. Yes, we'll all live in eternity. The question is, where will you spend eternity? Will you spend eternity in hell and in judgment, separated from God? Or will you spend eternity in heaven, where the Son of God has conquered death and made a way for sinners like you and I to live eternally with him in perfect and beautiful relationship? Guys, the reality is this. If you think that you're guaranteed heaven because your parents are Christians, you've got another thing coming. You can't, like, you know, surfing, ride on someone else's wave and get to where God has called you to be. You ride your own wave of salvation, if you know what I mean. You can't jump on the back of your parents' surfboard. You can't jump in the back of their minivan. You can't jump on the back of anything that they've done. You have to live out your own faith, all in on Jesus for yourself. They may pay for college, but they can't pay for your salvation. They might love you, and I'm sure they are so very proud of you, but none of that means that God actually knows you. And so the question also is, do you know God and does God know you? The only way that God is ever going to know you is if you believe in Jesus Christ. If you've given your life, you're trusting in him. That's the only way that God will ever know you. He knows no one apart from his son Jesus. And so the most important thing that you want to get or should hope to get out of this life is a relationship with Christ. So are you preparing for that? Are you dating, texting, posting, serving, thinking, studying, working, loving, forgiving, focusing, living like it will matter? Because if you look at the rest of our verse, the last part of verse 28, Jesus is going to appear a second time. He's going to come back. And the author of Hebrews says not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly awaiting for him. I don't think we talk about this in church enough. I know Redeemer does, but I don't think at large, in a general sense, we talk about Jesus coming back enough. And I know you're young and you all think you're going to live forever, but listen, the inevitability of time passing is something you will never escape. It is going to continue. You're never getting 12, 14, 25, 30, or 40 back again. It's never going to be February 16th, 2020 again. Time is moving very quickly. You once were young, now you're older. Pretty soon you're going to be much older. Time is passing away, and Jesus is coming back. And it is so easy to get caught up in the day-to-day, isn't it? So easy to get sucked into drama and the pleasures and cares of this world and forget about Jesus coming back. But if you believe in him, you belong to him. And if you belong to him, you are called to be living for him. And really what this verse says, eagerly awaiting him. So when life gets hard, that's why some people say, oh, God, have mercy. You ever hear that when there's a school shooting or something goes on? People say, Lord, have mercy. They're asking for the mercy of God in those moments because it's harder. People say, Jesus, come quickly. Oh, another tragedy. More lost lives under the age of 25. More young futures snuffed out by tragedy. Jesus, come quickly. Why do people say that? It's because they know the solution, the finality of everything is really Christ coming back. We need him to come back. We want him to come back. And we care about him coming back. And ultimately, we want to be living as though he's coming back. And so another question for you is, do you care about Jesus coming back? In the midst of your young life, are you living like there is a tomorrow? Because this is where YOLO falls short. You only live once, so live it up as though, you know, live like there's no tomorrow. Guess what? There will be a tomorrow. This passage is so clear, there will be. Jesus is coming back. And if you guys want to circle this in your Bible, it's probably one of those really important phrases that we would normally miss in our daily reading. Not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly awaiting. Listen, when Jesus comes back, there's no more second chances. He's not coming back to deal with sin. He already did that. He already died. So during this beautiful time in history, it's simple. Believe. Have faith. Give your life to him. Don't look back. Decide to follow Jesus. Do nothing else with your life but live completely and fully for him. Because when he returns, sin, repentance, turning to him, that'll all be past tense. People will have had to repent. Have had to have turned. They'll have had to take in this moment like you are tonight to hear God's word and to have faith and believe. I want to share with you a great story that Jesus tells in Luke 16:19 to 31. Listen to these words. There was a rich man, Jesus says, and he was clothed in purple and fine linen, and he feasted sumptuously. It's a good word. Just picture your big Thanksgiving feast. That's how this guy ate every day. Big rich guy. And at his gate, there was a poor man named Lazarus. He was covered with sores. He desired to be fed with just what fell from the rich man's table. You ever just said to someone, hey, let me just get the breadcrumbs. Let me just get what's fallen off your table, like a fry that tips over the edge of an In-N-Out, you know, fast food table. That's all Lazarus really wanted. Just let me catch a fry. And the dogs would come, and they would lick his sores. So this guy's poor, and he's sick, and he's hungry, and he's in pain. Well, the poor man died, and he was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. That means he's up in heaven. That's where Abraham is. The rich man also died and was buried, and in Hades, being in torment, which is a concept in the New Testament, Sheol in the Old Testament. These are words, if you ever come across them, these are exemplary or illustrations of hell, or in this case, where souls would be kept, or someone who's not a believer in God would be there, and not in heaven or in paradise, where someone would be ushered into the presence of God immediately after death if they're a believer. And so I don't get caught too much there, but just think kind of heaven, hell ideas, or away from God, separate in judgment, imprisonment and torment and with God, he lifted up his eyes. So the rich guy who had it all in life is suddenly in a really bad place, and he looks up and his eyes see Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he calls out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue." He's saying, just give me a drop of water over here. You ever heard that like hell is hot? That's the idea Jesus is conveying. Judgment, torment, discomfort. And Abraham says, "Child, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things." Whew. Remember that you lived it up. Hey, remember YOLO? Yeah, you took full advantage. Oh yeah, rich guy, you did it all. You felt it all, you ate it all, you drank it all in. And Lazarus, in like manner, he had the bad things. He had a tough life. But now he's comforted here, and you're in anguish. And besides all this, between us and you is a great chasm that's been fixed. What that means is basically there's no second chances. That gap between heaven and hell is very real. And once it has been determined where your eternity will be, that's where it's going to be. In order that those who would pass from here to you may not be able, so impossible to cross it. And he said, "Then I beg you." So now the rich man gets really desperate. "I beg you, Father." So Abraham, send the poor guy to my father's house and tell my five brothers, warn them, don't end up in this place of torment. Don't end up over here. They'll remember, you know, Lazarus. They'll remember the poor guy outside my door. Just send Lazarus to go and tell them. Because of course, they'll believe a crazy dead guy that comes back. They'll be having a vision and he'll go, "Hey, don't go to hell, go to heaven." Surely he would listen to them. And Abraham says, "If they don't hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead." The point of Jesus' story, as he's dealing with the snobby, snarky Pharisees, guys are all religious, they think they're all perfect, they got it all figured out. You know, Jesus was just a joke, a distraction to their lifestyle and their system. Yeah, Jesus is telling the story right in front of those guys. His point is this. Yeah, you think you're going to live it up on earth and not take a pause and live for God? You think you're going to have it all and it's not going to have consequences? No. You didn't listen to God when you were on earth. Through his word, the prophets, Moses, you want to fast forward that into after the cross, even now? That'd be like me saying, listen, you're not going to listen to Jesus, his parables, Paul, Peter, John, and the like. Jude and James are throwaways. You ain't going to listen to preachers now who preach God's word? Well, you're not going to listen to anybody. You're just going to go your way. The parable is a reminder that you get one life on earth, and you won't be wishing you partied more. You won't be wishing when it's all said and done that you had more boyfriends, more girlfriends, you went out more. You won't be wishing that you went to nightclubs or goofed off more, pushed the limits more, lied to your parents, lied to other people to get your way. You will either be rejoicing in the presence of God because, hey, you weren't perfect and you were even a little crazy, but you believed in Christ and you confessed your sins, and so God worked through you and he saved you and did incredible things through you. Oh yeah, you'll be looking back saying, "Hey, it wasn't perfect, Lord, but it was my best life for you while I had the chance to live on earth." Or you'll be staring across the chasm between heaven and hell, wishing for just one more opportunity to go back and not live it up for yourself, but live the one life you'd have on earth for Christ. Nobody will be thinking, "I wish I would have done more for me." And so, once again, YOLO on earth and how you live it will matter in eternity. I want to finish with giving you guys three steps that you can take tonight. Number one in your outline is this: get right with God while there's still time. The problem with our culture and this idea of good vibes and you only live once is that it's all so short-sighted. So get right with God while there's still time. You know, like the prodigal son. Who here's heard the story of the prodigal son? Who here has not heard the story of the prodigal son? It's okay if you haven't. Okay, so the prodigal son is this story in the New Testament where this young guy comes to his dad and goes, hey, I want my inheritance now. Give me all my money and I want to go to Vegas, more or less. Vegas wasn't around back then, but that's the idea. Imagine you going to your mom and dad and saying, okay, listen, I want you to mortgage the house, okay, or take out a second mortgage. Some of you don't know what that is, but just go home tonight, tell your parents that. They're going to look at you like you're crazy. But listen, go take out a second mortgage, okay? Go take out the equity in the house. I want my inheritance now. So drain your 401k, Dad. I need your retirement, okay? I need a few hundred G's because I'm going to go live my life now. And Dad says, hey, I love you. This is your right to an inheritance, and he gives you the money, okay? That's what Jesus told a story about, the prodigal son. He goes out, and what does he do? He invests, he starts a business, he buys a house that's a really good investment, he marries a woman who's really nice and settles down. No, he goes out and blows it all. He parties like a rock star, and he ends up one night after, if you will, you know, living it up in Vegas, saying, I guess I don't even have money for a hotel. I just got to sleep with farm animals. So this guy ends up sleeping with pigs. He goes from the penthouse to the pig pen. It's over. And then he thinks to himself, you know what? I might as well go back to my dad and just ask to be one of his slaves. Because at least then, hey, I'd be at dad's house. I'll just be a servant. I blew my inheritance, so it's over. But at least it'll be better than sleeping in a pig pen because my dad's own servants have it better than I do right now. And so Jesus explains, this guy goes back and his dad sees him. And it's not this moment like, hey, you big sinner, get out. Hey, you already took your inheritance. See you later. You're done. No more second chances. No, this guy pulls up his robes, and no old man would do that back then, and he just sprints down the driveway after his son, gives him a huge hug, and welcomes him home like a hero. A sinner. The guy who blew it. The kid who took everything and then just went and did what he wanted. The guy that you should say, oh yeah, told you so. Now head on back down the road. Go figure it out. You deserve what you got now. So go on. No, he welcomes him. Then he tells them, hey, slaughter the fattened calf. You know, take the biggest ox. We're going to have a real party now. We're going to welcome home my son. Gives him fancy clothes, puts a ring on him, loves on him. And the brother, his brother comes along and goes, Dad, what are you doing? Our brother, my brother, slept with prostitutes. He blew all your money. This guy's a lunatic. Now he comes back and you're going to act like it's okay? And listen to what the father says. He says to the good son, which probably sounds like you and I sometimes, when God saves sinners that we think are too bad to ever be saved. Son, you're always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But it was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for your brother was dead, and now he's alive. He was lost, and now he's found. Some of you, you're like the prodigal son. You've been lost. You've been acting like your way is the best way. You've been blowing it. You've been doing what you want. And an opportunity to look at a text from Hebrews like this and to think through the concept of only living once can only lead to one place, which is it is time to come home. It's time to give your life to Jesus. It's time to serve him fully and wholeheartedly. Because guess what? Yeah, there'll be some snarky people that say, oh yeah, you hypocrite. Oh yeah, now you think you're all spiritual. Oh, Miss or Mr. Holier than thou. No, at the end, you're just a kid coming home down the driveway. You know you've blown it. You know you're a sinner. But your Father in heaven sees you and he throws the biggest party that heaven could throw because you decided to get right with him. That's the call here. That's the extension for many of you. And those opportunities aren't always going to be there. So a night like tonight, if you live tomorrow, a day like tomorrow, is the opportunity to not waste your life, but to live it on purpose, to get right with God, to repent. That word, repent, means to turn away, go the other way of your sin, and give it all to God. Nothing is guaranteed in this life, but if you guys would get right with him, then eternal life, heaven with him, is guaranteed. Two, get the most out of this life by living for the next. So not just get right with God while there's still time, but get the most out of this life by living for the next. You know, you were made for a purpose. You weren't made to just kind of sit around and do whatever. You were made for purpose, to live on purpose. You've been adopted into the family of God if you're a Christian. Ephesians 1:5. God made you into a beautiful masterpiece of gifts and talents to do good works for his glory, Ephesians 2:10. So you are meant to make God famous. So do that. Make him famous. One of my favorite stories about missionary work is about Jim Elliot, American missionary who went as a young man, became a Christian, and went to Ecuador, South America, to save this tribe. The only problem is they were not a very nice tribe. And Jim Elliot shows up with his friends to save them and give them the gospel, and the only thing he gets is the tip of a spear. They kill him. He was there to share the love of God, and they slaughter him. True story. They had worked so hard to prepare. They had sent down care packages from their airplane. They would fly it over and throw down care packages and use a loudspeaker to communicate to the tribe. And all this to prepare for a friendly encounter. But in the end, they are viciously killed. But after his death, somebody was reading through his journal, his diary, and this is what they found. Jim Elliot writes, "He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose." He gave his life so that the gospel would go forth. He gave up his life. He decided, I'm going to live for Christ. I'm going to give the gospel to others, even if it costs me my life. And so in return, he got the thing that nobody could take. Even though his life was taken from him, the eternal treasure of knowing Christ and the glory of heaven was something that could never be taken from him or anybody else who believes in Christ. And miraculously, his wife goes back with their little daughter and ends up meeting the tribe, and guess what? They get saved. They hear the gospel, they believe, and the murderers even get saved. And one of the family members of one of the men who were killed actually becomes as close as family with the man who murdered his father. True story. And just back in 2015, one of the tribesmen who killed the missionaries, died at the age of 80. And he had spent the rest of his life after he got saved from that little tribe that hated American missionaries. He spent the rest of his life traveling around the world sharing the gospel. That is living on purpose. That is giving up what is going to be lost anyway. This life is going to end to gain what can never be taken, which is treasure in heaven, the glory of Christ. And so, yeah, you're not all going to go to Ecuador and die sharing the gospel. I understand that. But in whatever way God calls you and lays on your heart, surely, surely, if you're a true Christian, you might be willing to lose friends, money, popularity, relationships, opportunities, if it means gaining Christ. You get the most out of this life by living for the next. And the last thing is you get over this life by focusing on the next. You don't want to just get the most out of this life. You actually need to get over it, okay? Sounds a little harsh and insensitive, but it's true. You don't want to be holding on to this life. 1 John 2:17 says, "And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever." So this world, passing away. The will of God, in doing that, ensures that you abide, that you dwell with him forever. You know, YOLO, that idea, you only live once, hinges on this life being it for you. Culture today, the world is lying to you, telling you that you're a loser if you don't live it up for your own pleasure. You guys have heard of FOMO, fear of missing out. It's like a real thing, apparently. People go to the doctor for this. because they're scared to miss out on things. I mean, to me, it sounds like, you know, it started kind of when I was a kid, the self-esteem movement where everyone had to get a trophy, you know, and like there was, you couldn't win anymore at soccer or baseball. It's like everybody's a winner, and so you get a bunch of people that grow up and can't handle reality, and so now you got FOMO. Oh, I just don't want to miss out, fear of missing out. So everybody has a psychological disorder because they didn't get a trophy as a kid. I don't know what's wrong with culture, but the bottom line is people are soft, and people are scared to miss out. And the world says, oh, look at all the fun they're having on Instagram. You weren't there, you loser. Let me tell you, when it comes to sin and the world living it up, you're not missing out on anything, guys. Nothing. In fact, the best place you can be is here tonight. Best place you can go tomorrow, well, it's a day off, so you don't have to go to school, but you enjoy yourself with your family. The best friends you could have are friends who love Christ. The best relationships you could enter into are relationships that will push you harder and further into Christ than anything else. The only thing you're ever missing out on if you go all in on Jesus is everything that will lead you down a path of destruction. So yeah, you're missing out, all right, on everything that will destroy your life. When so many are missing out on the thing that will save their life. And so give that to others. Get over this life. Focus on the next. You will not miss out on God's amazing plan for your life if you live that way every single day. That's what I want for you. So forget YOLO. Focus on heaven. Understand you only live once here on earth. Make the most of it for Christ because you will live again. Whether that is eternity with God or eternity apart from God in hell will be up to whether or not you place your faith in Christ here and now today. Let's pray.